you may be wondering why this course costs so much. Well, the fact is, Katie had to fly me here to Rhodes, Greece, actually more specifically to Galathos, my mom's village, in order for me to show you what I'm going to show you about patients and how movement affects their vital signs. So, let's say you have a 35-year-old patient. His heart rate is 120. What are you going to do? Well, you have to remember that many of us every day have high heart rates, whether it's from pain, anxiety, stress, movement, you know, the sort of things that happen in the hospital all the time. So before you reach for that beta blocker, you need to think, okay, if this patient didn't have a monitor on, would I still want to treat them? You have to look at the patients for signs and symptoms. Of course, often signs and symptoms are very late are very late to tell you that something's wrong. For instance, if your patient is sedated, just lying there with a high heart rate or with a low SpO2 or something, obviously that's telling you, okay, their body's at rest. Other than cellular metabolism, nothing's happening, and they're still struggling to keep their vital signs normal. Obviously something very serious is happening. In anesthesia, we don't look at it as far as, well, I increased the propofol drip and, you know, that's all I could do. We just simply take care of the problem. We don't stop giving drugs until the outcome that we want has been achieved. Obviously, even in critical care nursing, that's not always a possibility. But you have to remember that you're not here to say or to chart that you did something. You're a nurse to make sure that the right things happen to your patients. So what I'm going to show you today is this is more important for larger patients and also for nurses who are doing sedation cases, but it can make a huge difference what your patient is doing. For the example, I'm going to show you a moving patient who's restless, maybe they're tachypneic, maybe they're starting to get anxious. That could be a very serious problem because their body needs so much more oxygen, glucose, you know, the two or three things that we really need to sustain life. So if a patient is just floating, like I can float here on this water for about a minute or two holding my breath, because here the Mediterranean, more specifically the Eastern Aegean, is filled with minerals and it's really easy to float, so I can hold my breath for a while. But, ooh, it's a little cold. But if I try, on the other hand, to swim and frantically dart around underwater, I won't last very long at all. So that's what I'm going to show you today, that as you're looking at vital signs, you also need to see what the patient is doing and marry those two things, the monitor and patient activity level, to see how serious is this problem, what's the next course of action, and in some cases, even though it sounds blasphemous, oh, this isn't really an issue, I can just go back to doing whatever I was doing. So I'm going to demonstrate how long I can last swimming underwater, just to show you that, again, floating in place or just lying there sedated is much, much different than a patient who's actively moving and having symptoms.